Good evening, good evening, good evening. How is God's people doing today? Come on in, come on in. This is the day that the Lord has made. I am rejoicing and I am so glad in it. Amen. Good evening, Sister Nikki. How you doing tonight? Praying for you always. My Sister Anthea, how you doing tonight? Come on in, come on in. Valerie, how are you doing tonight? God bless you. Come on in. Come on. Create a watch party. Share. Click like. Send up some hearts. Let's get ready for Bible study tonight. God has been so great. I just can't keep. I'm just sitting here just in my worship. I'm in my thankful mode. That's how great God has been. Hello, hello, hello. How you doing, Sister Janice? How you doing? God bless you. Sister Lisa, how you doing tonight? Bless you, bless you, bless you, bless you. Bless you, bless you. Sister Victoria, how you doing tonight? Sister Barbara Williams, how you doing? Amen. Sister Sandy McLean, how you doing? Blessings and covering. God is good. I'm going to wait a couple more minutes and get some more people to come on. The numbers are going up, and we just want to get into the Word tonight. As always, don't plan to be long. The great man of God, Dr. McLean, how you doing? Sister Shannon, how you doing tonight? Come on, as we wait on people, come on, somebody testify about what the Lord has been doing. If God has done something great for you, post it on this screen. Let us know that God is good, God is faithful. If he's healed you, he's blessed you, if he's given you favor in the area, come on, share it. We need more testimonies, because I told you a couple weeks ago, God told us we're going from expecting to experiencing. So the only way we experience things is when God has done it. And when God has done something great in your life, we want to testify how great God is. Come on. So as we come in, let's take a moment to clear our minds and keeps on blessing, keeps on showing me favor. I see all these great testimonies coming up. Amen. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Sister Dorothy, how you doing tonight? Bless you, the great woman of God. I love that woman there. Amen, amen. Amen. Brother Remo. Sister Kiki, amen. Got two more minutes and we're going to get started tonight. I'm looking for those testimonies. Sister Chica's mother, how you doing? Oh, that great woman of God. Oh, my God. Sister Felicia, how you doing this evening? Bless you. Healing. Amen. So again, make sure you come on, and some of you all start a watch party. Click like and click the heart, like the heart, and all that share, put the share button in. Let's kind of get into the Word tonight. Amen. I've got family out of town that are looking. Thank God for my family in Beaumont. I've got family in Dallas that are listening. Amen. To us tonight. Amen. Cousin Maxie, amen. Cousin Richard, he comes in sometime listening in. Sister Wanda Rogers, how you doing tonight? Amen. One more minute, we're going to get started. Is there anybody excited about, except me? Because I'm telling you, I'm so excited. I mean, I just can't really tell it. It's like every time I turn around, God keeps on doing something. Today he did something just really blowed the mind for the ministry. And I'm telling you, when I say God is up to some great things, I mean, don't never count God out. Don't give up. If he promises you something, please don't give up on God. Amen. You can give up on a man, but don't give up on God. If he said it, it will happen. Cousin Max, it's good seeing you. Belinda, praying for you. How you doing? Amen, amen. Sister Humble, how you doing? Amen. Okay, let's get ready to start. So tonight, let's take a moment just to clear our minds tonight. I believe when we get ready to hear the word of God, we have to prepare to receive the word of God. If you're going through anything, you're facing anything, you've got to learn how to put it out of your mind, or just plead the blood of Jesus, or give it to Jesus. Once you give it to Jesus, it's already taken care of. So I want the men and women of God to know, once we place something in the hand of God, Pastor Frank Richardson, good seeing you tonight in that great ministry that we're partnering with, we're doing some great things. I'm so honored to have you on tonight. But I just want to pray again. Let's clear our minds a second and make sure that we are in a position to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. One thing that God told me to relay to the people of God, I'm talking, but are you listening? It says, let the Spirit hear what God is saying. What is God saying to the church? And let me tell you something. In every situation of your life, God has something to say about it. Do not start a situation without hearing God. And remember, he's going to have the first word and the last word. So that's why victory comes in, because when we give it to God, he has something to say. And then when he finished with it, he still has something to say. When God gets through with something, it's something like, it's finished, it's over. Count it all joy. So let's get ready to pray. Father, we thank you tonight. Now, Father, we cannot minister to your people without you. Now, Father, help us tonight to get rid of every thought, every worry, every issue that's bombarding our mind tonight. And Father, I pray for a fresh word from you in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, speak to our hearts. Those areas that need adjustment tonight, we give you total permission to readjust our life to the place that God wants us to be. Now, Father, since our steps are already ordered by you, that every step that I'm taking, God, I know it's a God step. Now, Father, you said in your word that you promise never to leave us nor forsake. You said, lo, I'm with us always, even to the ends of the earth. So tonight, Father, whatever we need tonight, whatever your people are standing in need of tonight, we come in agreement tonight. We touch and agree that it's already done. Let healing power go over this airway tonight. I pray by the stripes of Jesus Christ, we are totally healed. Healing is the children's bread. And Father, help us to count it all joy. No matter what we face, no matter what we go through, you said count it all joy. Because, Father, it's working out for our good. When you get through with it, it's going to be good. And if it's not good yet, it simply means you're not through with it. So, Father, we just pray right now in the name of Jesus. We pray for this world. We pray for someone that's in a hospital right now, God. Father, as these cases go back up, God, I believe, God, you're still trying to get our attention, God. So, Father, I pray that the healing power is going to the hospital right now. There's a mother fighting for her life. There's a father on the life support machine right now. So, Father, we know that all things are possible through you. So, Father, we speak healing in that situation, God. We pray for our kids right now, God. I pray as they grow up and they grow up to young men and young women of God. And sometimes, Father, sometimes they go astray. Sometimes they go from the place that we train them to be, God. But Father, we pray that tonight, you said if we train them up in the way they should go, they might depart, but they've got to come back. So tonight, Father, I pray over every child right now in the name of Jesus. Some mothers worry right now. some fathers frustrated right now. But Father, wherever they might be, cover them with your blood. And Father, help us to realize that no matter what we face, no matter what we go through, that you are in control of everything. Now you said you got the king's heart in your hand, that you are turning to our favor. So tonight, Father, I pray that you release favor in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, Father, we're in a pandemic, but there's not a pandemic with you, God. Whatever we need, we serve a God that supplies all of our needs. Now, Father, do it for us, God. What you've done for others, you'll do the same for us. We don't have to be jealous of anybody else. We have a God who can bless us all at the same time. Now, Father, we pray tonight in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, let it be done this night. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Good evening, good evening, good evening. The wonderful people of God, it's a pleasure and an honor to be able to come on tonight and just have Bible study with you, kind of commune with you, to kind of just talk about the things of God. I've been praying, and one thing that God has kind of been placing on my heart is getting back to that place with Him. And again, I just want to kind of talk from my heart tonight. I believe that we need to get back to that place with God. Sometimes we allow distractions to get us out of that place with God. Remember, God is doing a work in all of our lives, and it's wonderful in His sight. Sometimes we look at the situation, and God says, you're judging something that's not even finished yet. One thing that you have to know as a man and a woman of God, God is going to finish what He started. And sometimes, yes, you have to go through the valley. Sometimes you have to go to that place where it doesn't feel good. But just know this one thing. When God gets through with it, it's going to come forth. It's going to be what it shall be in the name of Jesus. So again, rejoice tonight. I want some faces to be rejoicing tonight. I want some spirits to rejoice tonight. Because as long as God is in control, nothing can happen to us unless God allows it to happen. And if God allows something to happen, you better rest assured God's got a big plan for your life. So again, I just wanted to share that. That's just in my spirit. I'm getting a lot of texts. I'm getting a lot of phone calls from people being uncertain about which direction to go. When you don't know which direction to go, when you don't know what to do, let me just say this. Stand still. Just stand still and see the salvation of God. Don't move in a situation. Don't be forced in a situation unless you feel the peace of God. And that's just something I want to share with you all, because one thing I always look for, I always look for peace in a situation. If I don't feel the peace of God, then I know God ain't in it, because God promised me that He's going to give me His peace. Amen. So look for that peace in God and know that your steps are already ordered. All you got to do is stay in the Word, stay in worship, stay in praise. And remember, the Holy Spirit is leading us. Don't lead yourself. Let the Holy Spirit lead you. He's leading you into righteousness. He's leading you into those steps that God has already ordered for your life. So I just wanted to share that to start out, so encourage somebody. So again, tonight's lesson is just, I got to get back to God. And I think it's just time for us to admit that a lot of times we get out of the place with God. We got to get back to that place of God, get back to that hunger for God. The Bible says if we hunger and thirst for righteousness, we're going to be filled. What are you hungry for? I've got to get back to God. And that's something that I'm focusing more on, is getting back to that place with God. So tonight, I want you to look at Revelations 2 and 4 and 5. We'll just go right there tonight. And I believe that God is going to say something to us tonight. Because again, the title is Getting Back to God. Getting back into that place with God. Come on, think about the place when you first started, that love you had for God. Think about how you used to feel when you first got saved. Come on, when nothing else mattered, the only thing that mattered was God. So again, this is what God is talking to the church about. It says, nevertheless, I have something somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Now listen, it says, you have left your first love. Remember therefore from whence thou hast fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come to unto thee quickly, and I remove thy candlestick out of its place, except thou repent. Again, this is God talking, so I got to get back to God. Come on, God say, I have something against you because you have, I didn't leave you, you left me. You have left your first love. God said, remember where you have fallen, repent, and turn back to your first work. So let's kind of get into this word tonight, and I'm just going to make a couple of statements to start out with, and I believe God's going to help us. Now, the first thing I want you to make sure to articulate to you, God wants to be first in all of our lives. Somebody put that on your paper. God wants to be first in all of our lives. And if anything or anybody becomes first in our life, we have created an idol. And that's deep. I want to take that real slow. God wants to be first in all of our lives. And if anything or anybody becomes first in your life, you have created an idol. And let me tell you something. When you put something first in the place of God and you start focusing more on that than God, you have created an idol. So I want you to take a moment to think about, have I created any idols in my life? And maybe the reason why we don't have a relationship with God that we desire is because we're not looking for God for our guidance and our understanding. Our victorious living only comes from God. We have to value our relationship with God. Now, I want you to understand that there. So if you got a relationship and you desire a relationship with God, you got to look to God for everything. God is the supplier of everything. And we have to have understanding. And the victorious life that we are trying to live, it only comes from valuing our relationship with God. Somebody say amen now. So again, you know, I want you to take a moment, and I want to articulate this. Take a moment to think about, am I placing anything in the place of God? Because there are some things that only God can do. And all the glory and all the honor goes to God. Most of us are focused on religion. Come on. We're focused on religion. We have the platform. We know how to quote the scriptures. We know how to impress people. But we don't know how to have a relationship with God. What good does it do all this stuff that we call church and we stand before people and we can quote scriptures and we don't have a relationship with God? And one thing that God desires is a relationship with all of us. And God wants to say one thing. I know what you're thinking. See, you can't fool God. God knows you. Come on. Somebody put it, God knows you. I know what you're thinking. I know what's in your heart. And I know what you're going to do before you even do it. See, some of us, we think that we can manipulate God. And one thing God began to minister to me, he said, tell my people, I know you. I know the thoughts that you think. I know what's in your heart. I know before I even do it, I know what you're going to do when you get it. And God is not asking to be first. He is demanding to be first in your life. So I want to make sure you hear that tonight. Because I can minister over and over again. That's one thing that God is not debating. God is demanding to be first in your life. And the question is he first? And if he can't be first in your life, guess what? Our life is going to be full of trouble. Amen. You're going to be depressed. It's going to get lonely. So again, God wants to be first in our lives. Come on. I want you to hear that tonight because I'm just so concerned again, and I want to take my time to articulate it. I'm so concerned about we are focusing so much on religion and we're not building a proper relationship with God. Come on. If you're going to have a relationship with God, that means you got to set up time for God. Come on, we are compromising religion over relationship. And one thing I know that God wants a relationship with you, not just when you're in trouble. God wants a relationship. When you get up in the morning, God wants to hear your voice. Amen. When you're on your way to work, God wants to hear your voice. There ought to be a continual communication with God. Let me tell you something. I can't stop thanking God enough for all the things that he's done in my life. Come on, I can't thank him enough. So again, some of us have left our first love. And it's sad that things are getting in the way of God. Amen. Come on. You have to know that you left your first love. When you have to find time for God, that means you left your first love. When you have to find time to put God in, and you can find time to meet with your girlfriend, you can find time to go see a good movie, you can find time to see a TV show, but you have to schedule, you have to find time for God. Whenever you have to find time for God, you have left your first love. Amen. Amen. And God saying, I don't want to be your God, you just get around to. And most of us are treating God just like that. I'll get around to praying. I'll get around to reading my word. If you do this, then I'll do that. And God said, I don't want to be your get around to me, God. I want to be first in your life at all times. So the question is, how do I fix it? How do I get back to God? How do I get back in the presence of God? Now listen, I want to say this one thing, and this is going to help you. I'm trying to stay calm because I feel like I want to holler and scream. I want to jump and holler. But listen, you got to first admit that God is gone. Sometime when God leaves, things begin to get unclear. We get to wondering if he's going to do stuff. It's when I don't feel his presence. That's one thing that I do fear. I fear about the presence of God not being in my life. You know, I've got over when people leave because people will be people. But one thing I always pray is, God, please don't leave me. I need your presence. I need your guidance. I need your understanding. I need your counsel. I need to feel your reassurance. So I've got to have the presence of God. I've got to have my relationship with God. I don't just want to come into a building and do all these things. I don't want to do my high-fiving my neighbor. I don't want to do my rituals and all that. I sit in the same seat, but I don't even have that relationship with God. And God said, most of us, we go in a church, and God said, I don't even go with you. You just going doing some religious service or something. Because my relationship doesn't start when I get to church. It starts before I ever get in the building. So how do I fix it? How do I get back into that presence of God? How do I get God back into my life? I'm glad you asked. There are five R's that can reconnect us back to God. Five R's that can reconnect us back to God. So the first thing that God gave me in these five R's is, number one, is to remember. Somebody say remember. Remember how it was when you started with God. This helps me get back into place. Remember how it was when you first got saved. Remember how it was when nothing mattered but just feeling God's presence. Come on, let's go back. See, if I'm going to fix it and I'm going to put God back number one in my life, if I'm going to make him the first thing in my life, I got to remember how it was. Come on, Palace. Remember how it was when we first started and people laughed at us and told us, ain't nobody coming in no funeral home, that y'all lost y'all mind. Remember how it felt when we just walked the streets. We went over to Yale Village and walked all down Yale, knocking on people's doors saying, come to a church. We're a different type of church. And for some Sundays, nothing happened. Then all of a sudden, they started coming. And they started coming. And the same preachers that laughed at me and said it wasn't going to happen, I was losing my mind. In 1 year, we had more members than some of them had. Come on, remember how it felt before you got a position, before you got all the name brand clothes, when sometimes you wore the same old clothes, you were just happy being in the house of God. And I believe that if we're going to get back to God, if we're going to get our love right with God, we got to remember what God has brought us. Come on. God has done a work in all of our life, and it's marvelous in his sight. Come on. Me and my mom talk sometimes, and sometimes I know she's going to get mad at me. I look at her closet and say, boy, you came a long way. Because he used to tell me the stories about how rough it was for them growing up and how they had to pack water and all that kind of stuff. And I used to go to my grandmother's house. They had an outhouse out there. But one thing they had was plenty of love, and they had plenty of God up in there. So remember where you came from. And I think when we start to remember where we came from, before you got your title in the church, come on, if we could just remember how it was nothing but God. I remember the presence of God. I remember when I had an experience with God. I remember my relationship with God. I used to sit and just talk to God one-on-one. And then people would say stuff like, man, you okay? Because nothing else mattered. And I think because we have allowed so many things to get in the place of God that we have forgotten to work on this relationship with him. Listen, I'm not hollering. I just want to articulate this here. You know, I thank God for where he have us at now up in Spring. But let me tell you something. I love over here by Yale. I love this the funeral home where we started. I love this place because it showed me the power of God. God can take nothing and make something out of nothing. So I remember. And that's why I don't understand how people get so into themselves. I remember when people first came to church, we had our guards up and we would protect the anointing. And we got around certain people, we started doing the things they doing, compromising this and compromising that. And next thing, we compromise our relationship with God. Till we don't see miracles and signs and wonders. I told them when I was praying, God said, stop talking about expectation. Because that's what everybody's talking about, expectation. God said, it's time to experience my power right now. Come on, let's remember. I came up through a church, CC Driver Revival, at Dr. Allison Church. And, you know, I would go to the church in my regular church in the morning, but I wanted more. I remember that. It wasn't just enough to go to a Sunday morning service. It was that evening, that night service up there. And I would see demons cast out. I would see people get in the prayer line and they would lay hands on the sick and they would recover. I would see an atmosphere where it felt like something was in my eyes. It seemed like the whole place would smoke up. This was the power of God. We do all this stuff now. We do it fast and quick and in a hurry. And I have, Pastor, sometimes you preach too long. But let me tell you something. You don't know what tomorrow holds for nobody. It might be somebody's last chance. So again, if I'm going to get back to that place with God, if I'm going to put God first in my life, I got to remember. I got to take a stroll down memory lane. You didn't make yourself. God made you. Come on, he's using you. He's giving you his power. He's giving you his anointing. He's giving you a platform to represent him. How could you contaminate it with your flesh? We've got to get back to that place. And I know this is not a popular message because we want to hear stuff that make us feel good. But some of this stuff making us feel good going to send us straight into hell. There's no fear of God anymore. One thing I remember about the Holiness Church and the Sanctified Church, let me tell you something, they had a fear of God. And my problem is now the fear of God has left the building. We do anything. We say anything. Come on. We're in the presence of God. We're more concerned about our Facebook, our Instagram. We're more concerned about, and right there, supposed to be in the presence of God. So again, if I'm going to get back to that place, if I'm going to get back to that place with God, because God say, listen, I have something against thee because you have left your first love. Come on. He said, you left your first love. And God wants us to return back to him. Return back to him. So the second thing that God told me, the first thing is remember. The second thing God told me to get us back in that presence with him is to repent. Somebody say repent. That means to turn back. We have a sin issue in our life. Come on. We don't have a God issue. We have a sin issue. Come on, God is no longer number one in our lives. So again, if I'm going to return back to God, you know, I have to deal with sin. And let me say this, and I got to make sure I articulate this here. Anytime you put God second, it's a sin. Pastor, that ain't the Bible. Well, the Bible clearly states that thou shalt have no other gods before me. So again, if I'm going to get back to that place with God, I've got to repent. Come on, a true repentance, turning back to God. We've got to admit, God, I have not kept you number one. I have created other gods to take your place. Come on, it's a sin issue that we need to be dealing with. Because what have you created other than God? If you look for anybody to do anything but God, you have created an idol. And we have too many idols being created in the church. Somebody say repent. There are things that God cannot do. First of all, God cannot lie. God doesn't steal. God doesn't go against his word. But there's one more thing that God can't do. God cannot be second to anything or anyone. Woo! Somebody put that in the notes right there. God cannot be second to anything or anyone. So again, we got to make sure that we're in repentance. You know, if you place anything, if you consider with anybody before you went to God, if you're looking for anybody to do anything but God, guess what? You're creating an idol. Because one thing about your life has a mandate from God. And let me tell you, just like Abraham, they tried to bless Abraham with money. Abraham said, I'm not going to receive this from you. Listen to the anointing talk. Listen how the anointing talks. Abraham, they tried to give him money. They wanted to give him a whole bunch of money and stuff. He said, I will not receive this from you unless you say you made Abraham. And sometimes when we start taking stuff from other people and they start talking about what they did for us, there are some people that talk about how they made you and they help you along the way. Listen, all my help comes from the God. One thing that I do know, that God's got the king's heart in his hand. And he can turn it to my favor anytime he gets ready. And let me tell you something. If he didn't turn the king's heart, I don't need it. Because let me say, I don't want nobody getting the glory for what God is doing. So I got to make sure that I'm repenting. Because sometimes you're the one that has become the idol. You too high on yourself. You think too much of yourself. You need to humble yourself down. Come on, you need to stop exalting yourself. You need to come down that so God can be edified in you. So again, we got to repent. That simply means to turn. So if my relationship is not right with God, then nothing else is going to be right. And when any time that God is not first in your life, your relationship is always going to be in turmoil. It ain't the preacher. It ain't the worship service. It's you. Come on, David, you are that man. So we have to admit it. And I don't believe that's enough repentance going on. Because we're doing stuff right now that I don't even believe is God. We are doing stuff to make us feel good. We are, you know, all this is stuff like the world needs, we got something. Yeah, we got something the world. We got Jesus. That's the only thing that we got the world need. We don't need their money. If God get ready to bless you, he know how to bless you, baby. You don't want to get money from somebody else and they talking about what they done for you and all that. There was a man one time came to the church and he said, listen, God told him to bless the church and all this stuff. And I'm cool with that. But one thing he said, listen, you got to change the name of the church. You got to come up on our organization and you got to say that what we're doing and we're going to do. No, that's not the plan of God for this ministry. So again, we got to repent. Somebody say repent. So I can stay there longer, but I feel somebody's getting a little anxious when I'm a little uncomfortable about repenting. Repent. It's just simple. Lord, I'm sorry for putting anything or any person in the place of you. Sometimes too much TV. You know, you don't even have time for God. I had to repent for that. I said, God, listen, I didn't watch news all day long and wondering about what Trump going to do next and stuff like that. And God said, you could have been wondering about what I'm going to do next. You got all the things that are going on in the world. There are some things that I want to reveal in this Bible. And I need you to be in this Bible. I need you to be on your faith so I can communicate with you, so I can talk to you, so I can show you some things to come. I can show you some things before they even going to happen that's going to blow some people's mind. It comes from a relationship with me. Mm-hmm. So again, we've got to repent for that. Repent for leaning to my own understanding. There have been times when people say this was God and you got out of the total will of God. You said it was God. Well, if it's God, how did you get out of the will of God? Because we have left our first love. Come on, man should not live by prophecy alone. Come on, repent for being a prophecy. I had to repent for that too. All I did, chase, ran around town looking for a word from God, trying to buy a word from God. I'm glad somebody taught me that I don't need to buy a word from God. I've got 66 books in here. God speaks to you. If you don't have no money, you're still going to be blessed. If God say you're blessed, can't nobody going to curse you. And all a man can do is confirm everything God's going to do for your life. So again, you can save some of that money. Get in your word. Yes, he reveals it to the prophet, but he'll reveal it to you too. If you're in the right position, in the right place. So again, remember, come on, repent. And the third one is return. Somebody said return. If I'm going to return to God, again, I've got to admit I first left him. Anytime I have to find time for worship, I have to find time to read my word, I have to find time for fellowship, it means that I have made God priority in my life. And God said, I want to have first. I don't want you to have to wonder. I want you to schedule me. Schedule an appointment with me. Come on, wake up in the morning and say, God, we're going to meet at 6 o'clock in the morning. We're going to meet at 5 o'clock in the morning. So again, we got to make sure that we understand this. Somebody say amen on this here. So return. Somebody say return. Return to your first love. That means that I've got to have my mind on him. When I wake up in the morning, my mind is on God. So I got to return to God. I got to return to that place. I got to return to that place where I first, I'm going to tell you where I found him. I found him on the carpet. I was on the carpet crying out. That was the place I got to return. That's where my strength came from. The lower I seemed like I got, the more God began to talk to me. So again, I had to return back to God. And I'm not just telling you, I'm telling myself this. Because God wants to do some great excerpts in all of our lives. I don't care who you are. I don't care where you were born at. I don't care if you have money, you don't have money. Let me tell you, God is looking for somebody to show himself strong in. So again, return to God. God wants to be the first thing on your mind when you wake up, and he wants to be the last thing on your mind when you go to bed. So again, return to him. Whatever you got to do to get in that position. And returning, sometimes you got to cut some people off so you can return back to God. Because if it's not a plan for God, sometimes people can keep you from the total plan of God. So again, make sure that you know we have to return to God. Okay, number four, I'm almost through. I got to reposition myself. Come on, somebody said reposition. Reposition myself. When you are out of position, you lose signal, you lose communication, you lose favor. It's only when you reposition ourselves where God can get the glory, then God can begin to talk. Okay? When we reposition our lives and put God where he needs to be, then we can activate favor over our lives. We can walk in the steps that God has ordered for us. Then God gets good pleasure out of our lives. So if I'm out of position, when I say reposition, that means I've got out of position. When you are out of position, you lose signal. That's a communication that God is talking to you when you're moving out of the place that God wants you to be. And this is how the enemy always operates. He always tries to get us out of position. So if I'm going to return back to God, I've got to reposition myself back in the place where I belong with God. Come on. He's already ordered your steps. Your steps are ordered by the Lord. So again, when was the last time you heard from God? When was the last time God spoke to you in your spirit? When was the last time you just opened up the Bible and God just flipped it to write what you need? See, God has already positioned you into a place of favor. He's already positioned you into a place where you need to be at with him. It's only when I get out of position, and sometimes I get out of position by leaning to my own understanding. Help me, Holy Ghost. I'm not trying to just tell you something. I'm telling you what I have to apply to my life too. Because sometimes people can be distractions. Sometimes you being over anxious for something and God's not moving fast and you go to try to help God, you can lose position. So if I'm going to get back to that place with God, I got to reposition myself back into that place. Come on. The Bible says he'll exalt you in due season. Maybe it's not your due season. Why are you trying to make something happen when God says it's not your due season? Hallelujah. So again, wait on the Lord. Again, I say wait on the Lord. So stay in your position until you wait. Yes, pastor, you're going to be a pastor one day, but wait till God anoint you to go out to be a pastor. Don't try to do it on your own. A lot of this stuff is because some of us don't want to be in order and we don't want nobody to tell us that, so we go create something out of order. So again, we've got to admit that sometimes we get out of position. I've seen people, you know, get mad about little stuff. And then I'm gone. Well, you're not hurting God's house. Let me say this here. Let me articulate this here so somebody can get free tonight. When you leave a position because you are angry, because you're mad, because you can't come to a place where you can humble yourself, or you can't have nobody to chastise you, somebody to correct you. When you leave out of that position and go, it doesn't stop the house from progressing. God always has a ram in the bush. There have been so many people. That's how you know when it's God's house, God, whatever's going to happen, God already knows it's going to happen. And a real man of God, when you're in the right position, God will tell you what's going to happen. Most of the stuff that's happened in the palace of praise, God had already told me. He said, it's going to happen like this. This is going to happen. They're going to leave here. They're going to do this here. But he said, don't even worry. I got something. I've already got a ram in the bush. So again, it doesn't stop what God is doing. People can leave out of your life because they can see proclivities. They can see shortcomings. They can see you coming up short. They can see some things not lining up with you like they think it should. Don't mean God ain't with you. Because if you read your Bible, it took these disciples, they didn't happen overnight for him. Peter just didn't stop cussing. And I'm not giving you no pass to stay in your sins and just, I got grace. No, at some point, you got to turn from your ways. You got to get back in that position. But let me tell you something. There's a process that you go through. And even though you see proclivities in somebody, you don't know the relationship that people have. Come on, the struggle is real. Paul wrote most of the New Testament. He said stuff like this: the good that I want to do, I don't do it. And that I don't want to do, I end up doing. He's crying out for help. Who can help me? And some of us want to pretend like we've always been here, like God talked to us all our lives, and we've never done nothing wrong. We never failed. We never messed up, and we've been great all our life. Well, God bless you. But for the rest of us, the struggle is real. And I can admit that sometimes that my feelings have got hurt and I've got out of position. In my former church, my feelings, I stayed on and God chastised me. He said, you go back and you don't leave until I release you. And I stayed right there and I took it. I stayed right there until God released me. And when God released me, he released me with a blessing. Because I didn't even know where the palace of praise gonna be. When I went to talk to my pastor and told him what God was doing, he didn't say wonderful. He didn't say I bless you. He said okay. And he said, well, all he wanted to know what was going on in the church at. And I didn't even know nothing about spring 1960. I said, you don't have to worry about nothing, pastor. I said, God is gonna open up the church. It's gonna be far from here, so you don't have to worry about me trying to do this or do that. I said, 1960 spring. And I didn't even know what I was even saying. And where's the church at right now? I fumbled it out of my mouth. And when I said, what made me say that? The church is right where God told me it would be. I told him 1960 spring, and that's where the church is. See, God has a plan for all of our lives. So listen, I don't preach from what I've heard. I don't preach from what other preachers do. I preach from what I've experienced with God. And that's why my passion for God, you know, they might get me here. They might get me on this, the theologian, the deep part. They might get out of hermeneutics me and all that kind of stuff. I'm cool with that. But my experience I have with God, can't nobody take that away from me. I can tell you, you can buy land with no money. I can tell you that God would turn the king's favor in your hand. That one conversation with a man that you don't even know is a multi-millionaire, and God say, everything you need, he talked to me, everything you need, I got you. And most of all the property, about millions of dollars property, he financed it for me. See, God got a bigger plan, and his plan is bigger than you. I don't need nobody to be philosophizing to me. I need somebody to tell me, hey, how do I get my relationship back to God so the blessings of God can come on my life, so I can be a voice for God, so I can have favor in my life to look at a situation and not look at it and just pray. Some of you just looking at situations and pray. I don't want to just pray. I want to be able to write a check. I want to be able to turn something around. I want to be able, just like we, our church, be able to give the young lady in a car. I want to be able to give calls to these young boys and let them know your church got your back. I want to help a single mama that's trying to live holy, trying to live for God, and she's struggling. I want her to be able to say, listen here, for 6 months, we got you. Put your money in the credit union, and we're going to match whatever you have. This is what I'm talking about. I'm tired of all this here. They don't like me, and this, that. They got my position. He don't care about it. Man, we're not doing kingdom work. It's almost like a daycare center. We're trying to keep everybody happy. We're trying to, oh, she didn't really mean it. Well, come on, apologize. Well, I didn't mean it. Sister, you think I got time to be sitting at you, going home, working up a sermon just to preach about you? Most of the time I'm preaching, I didn't preach to myself. I didn't repent. Before I even read this, I got on my knees and repented. How am I going to sit in a church and make a whole sermon about you? No, the Holy Ghost will use a sermon to expose those weak areas in your life. Calm down, Pastor. Okay, I will. So again, you know, we got to make sure that we're in that place with God. Reposition yourself. Reposition your life. There's a way you can reposition your life where blessings flow in your life. And I would dare not insult God. I'm not going to get on this thing and say, we're in a pandemic. Man, I'm telling you, I've been blessed. During this pandemic, I mean, I've been blessed. The church has been blessed. The people of God been blessed. Myra was telling me a testimony. She gonna tell her she was telling me a testimony. I know God with her. When she tell that testimony, I want everybody to hear that. See, it's the little things. Sometimes we think things got to be so big and so grand. Sometimes, man, there been blessings that came to me I didn't even ask for. There's a Caucasian lady, I just met her one time doing a job for somebody else, and they didn't even pay me. I wrote it off. And she heard about me. She heard about the work I did, and she came and hired me. She said, I want you to, she had all these properties all over town. She said, I want you to handle all my properties. And let me tell you something, I made some great money with her. And I don't have to fuss with her about no price. She said, hey, just get it done and send me an invoice. And the checks keep on coming. I'm just trying to tell you, I have to take time to brag about my God. Same thing. We're in the funeral home business. And listen here. My mom's at home right now. She said, God told me to take it from a business to a ministry. He said, listen, this is my work, but I don't want you to treat it like a business. I want you to treat it like a ministry. He said, every family that comes in there, I want you to grab hands and pray for them and help them along the way. And I'm going to give you the words to speak into their life while they're going through this situation. And let me tell you something. It turned the whole situation around. God knows how, when you position yourself into the blessings of God, when you position yourself into the word of God, when you get your worship right, you get your relationship right, then God is going to do some great things. So reposition. That was the forward. And then God say, it's time for us, if we're going to get back in that place, we got to recharge. Say recharge. Recharge your life. Come on, recharge. That means that God says sometime in this walk of what we call Christianity, sometime we go through things. And sometimes we get weak. And God says, what needs to happen when I recharge, I take all the negative stuff you're going through and I put my positive on your negative, And I give you a jump start of the Holy Ghost and power to complete your purpose. Woo! Hallelujah. I felt it in my spirit. Some of us need to say, God, recharge me. Because some of us, we keep giving out and we keep getting hurt and we keep on trying to live this life and things hurt us. And sometimes people take our holiness for weakness and all this kind of stuff. It seems like I'm praying for everybody else and my kids acting a fool and all this kind of stuff. Sometimes we just need to be recharged. If I'm going to get back to that place with God, I've got to allow God to recharge me. And the only way God can recharge me, I've got to allow him to put his positive, and that's the word of God, on all the negative. And when you allow God to put the word of God on all the negative that's coming in your life, it's going to jumpstart you. It's going to wake your Holy Ghost up. It's going to tell you to count it all joy. Then you'll start laughing. And they'll say, what's so funny? And you'll say, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Then you start saying nothing. When he jumpstarts you and recharges you, you start saying stuff like, no weapon formed against me is going to prosper. When people shut doors on you, you laugh. You say, I'm not even offended by it. You just ain't the one. And you keep on going, and you keep on getting a hit. You keep on going. And after a while, you got some Holy Ghost strength where you can stand against your adversary. And you can start saying, Satan, get thee behind me. So I'm telling you that we need to get to a place of recharge. Your Holy Ghost battery is low. Your Holy Ghost battery is dead. The problem is you've been getting boosts from the wrong people. And let me tell you something. A negative can't jumpstart a negative. Who are you allowing to jumpstart you? They don't have the power. And that's why God said he'll allow the Holy Ghost to jumpstart those areas. Let me tell you, there have been times where the Holy Ghost, it was a negative situation, and my battery was low, and I felt like giving up. The Holy Ghost said, keep on going. God got a blessing up the road. I was hearing no, 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 no. Bank after bank after bank after bank after bank. I got tired of hearing no. Then I met one man named Russell Apshit, the vice president of Sterling Bank. And one thing that he said to me that I knew was God, he said, listen, your credit is all right. He said, but it's one thing I can't understand. How could you have obtained all this stuff you got, all this stuff you've accomplished? How could you get all this stuff without a bank? And that's, guess what I said? God did it. See, when the banker testified, he can't figure out how did all this come up and how did you get this? How did you get the land? How did I say God did it? And guess what he said? He said, well, we're going to get on board with the ship. He said, I'm going to give you this. Then he gave me this. And then he gave me this. Then he gave me 100. Then he gave me 500. Then he gave me. See, it kept going on. See, the favor of God is real. And that's why I can preach this. I'm telling you, recharge. And stop letting people who don't have enough power to get their car, Holy Ghost car started, trying to start your car. You telling me how to do something? Let me see what you've done. If you're going to talk to me about money, the first thing I want to see is your checkbook. I can read the word for myself if you're going to tell me something God did for you. And we are listening to people where it hadn't been proven by God. And I said it. And guess what? My relationship with people getting tighter and tighter. Because I let these problems, man, don't come with all that crazy stuff with me. Just tell me what said the Lord. And listen, I tell some of these prophets, when I talk to them Facebook, get a job, man. Stop all this hustling stuff. Don't get up in no morning talking about, I need 55 people to send me 25. You need somebody to tell you to go to get you a job. The word of God is free. And you're not going to manipulate God's people because you don't want to get to work. You got to hustle on. No, I'm going to teach the people right. I'm telling you that God can do it. You pick up your word. You get your relationship with God. You get in the right place with God. God will open up the windows of heaven. He'll pour you out blessings. He'll give you a voice. And the same people that's been teaching you, he'll have you teaching them. Yeah, I don't like my message tonight, but I'm feeling the Holy Ghost over here. I can testify about my God. And I got one more, then we can get out of here. So again, if I'm going to allow God, get God back in that place, not only do I have to return back to God, not only do I have to reposition myself, not only do I have to recharge myself, but guess what the last thing I gotta do? I've got to rejoice. Somebody say rejoice. God say, in order for you to return back to me, there has to be rejoicing. First of all, now I've admitted. I'm going to show you how this goes. How you close this, Pastor Free. I'm glad. He said, now listen. Now I've admitted that I had not been in the proper place with God. I repositioned myself. And God said, I've gone through all the stages. God said, it's now time to rejoice. Now you back at home. And what does it look like? It looked just like the prodigal son. The prodigal son, he left his first love. He left the father. And went did everything he wanted to do. Then the Bible says he came to his senses. Woo! I wish somebody would type that on because I feel the Holy Ghost. He came to his senses. And he said, listen, I'll go back and be the lesser. I just want to get back to the Father's house and up under the Father's grace. And he goes home. The Father sees him. Woo! Been looking for him. And guess what? The Bible says he runs to him and grabs him and he begins to love on him. And he starts saying, Father, I've done wrong. He said, be quiet. I don't want to hear that. The main thing is you back in position. He said, come on, bring me a robe. Come on, give me a ring. Give me some shoes. This is my son. This is my daughter. Come on, whoever you are. Once was dead, now you're alive. Come on, let's celebrate. Let's rejoice. And boy, let me tell you something. They had some kind of party. But let me put a little emphasis there. Everybody ain't going to want to come to your party. Because let me tell you something. He was gone. He was back. He went through the stages. Now he's repositioned himself. Now they're rejoicing. But guess what? Everybody ain't happy. His brother is not happy. His brother said, why you throwing him a party? He did this, he did this, he did this, he did this. He took all the money and he wasted on women and all that kind of stuff. How dare you bless him? The daddy said, listen, you got the wrong spirit. Everything I have is yours. It ain't no, come on, let's rejoice that your brother made it back. And I want to tell somebody on here, God said tonight, rejoice. Just rejoice. Rejoice. Come on, admit you've been out of position. Admit that I got to get back to God. Come on, remember what he done for you. Remember where he brought you from. Come on, I feel like preaching. Come on, repent. Come on, somebody say repent. Come on, you got to repent. Get back in that place. So you have to rejoice that the Father loves you and his love for you does not change. Now listen, I didn't want to get into all that, but this is how I live my life. I'm not on here trying to impress anybody. Let me tell you something. Hey, my life is an open book. I told y'all I've done it. If they say it can be done, I've probably done that. Hey, so if anybody say your pastor did something, no, you don't have to fight for me. Just say, listen here, he probably did. But just tell him also, he old enough to speak for himself. Mm-hmm. God told me to preach. I kept running. And let me tell you, I got myself in a situation. And he showed me three things. He showed me a graveyard, a jail cell, and a pulpit. And let me tell you something. It wasn't hard to pick which one I need to go to. I picked the pulpit. So again, tonight, I just want to make sure I articulate this tonight. You know, I want to make sure that we get into that place. I want to make sure that your hunger for God is there. I want to make sure you are allowing God to finish the work that he started. And he's like, let me tell you, nothing you can do can separate you from God. I mean, I don't care where you are, what you've done. God is faithful. He'll forgive us for our sins. Stop letting people hold you in your past and you got a future. Remember, just God. Whoa, that's, I wish I could sing. I'm working on my singing. That song you say, take me back, God. Take me back, dear Lord, to the place where I first received you. Man, I remember that. And one thing that I get happy about when I can think about the great times we've had in the past. Now, listen, I didn't say stay stuck in the past. I remember that. But let me tell you something. I believe that God wants to give us a testimony right now. He don't want to just talk about things he used to do. What is he doing right now? Get yourself in a position with God so he can do some right now stuff for you. I told God, take my life and I give it all to you. They can call me crazy. They can laugh at me. They can say he ain't this, he ain't that, he ain't this. But guess what they can't deny? They can't deny that the hands of God is on my life. Yes, I've been through it. I've been through the divorce. Yeah, you can say, well, you don't know. I've been through all of that. I've been through a bankruptcy. I went bankruptcy trusting a pastor. I mean, lost everything. But I can stand and say everything I lost, God gave me double for my trouble. Yeah. Get your heart. Get it out of your heart. Get it out of your heart. Come on, let some people go. Forgive some people. Your chapter ain't over. God is writing new chapters in your life. But it all starts by getting back to God. Come on. Come on. You left your first love. God loves you. Come on. He didn't love you to be angry and mad and bitter. He didn't love you and die for you to be jealous and unforgiveness. He didn't die for you to always talking about a poverty mentality that you can't have nothing, that you all you can do is talk about other people. He didn't save you where you can argue about this and argue about that. Man, just love people. Love the hell out of people. Just love people. That's all. That's your job, loving people. Loving God with everything and loving people. And all the rest of it hangs around that. Those are the two commandments he said. Loving me with everything that you got and loving your neighbor like you love yourself. You don't send yourself to hell. You don't roll your eyes at yourself. You don't talk about yourself. Come on. So let's make sure that we get this all in order tonight. So again, I love you so much. And you know, like I said, again, this is what God gave me tonight. Now listen, it's getting late. Boy, my big mama, boy, she take me to this church and this lady used to sing this song. It's getting late in the morning, in the evening. The sun's about to go down. Come on, church. It's getting late. This coronavirus, I don't really believe this world will never be the same again. Come on. People are dying. We're seeing stuff now that we stuff been here. Now all these videos are coming out, and we're seeing what these policemen and stuff been doing and all this, and shooting these young black men like dogs in the street. I saw one day had a young boy getting on the ground, say, crawl to me. He was crawling, doing everything he could do, and a man still shot and killed him. Come on, we got to pray. Come on. If my people, are you a child of God? If my people are called, humble yourself. Come down. We got the reason God can't hear you, you're too high up. Come down. Humble yourself. If my people are coming, humble yourself and pray. Turn, seek my face. Come on, you do what God say do. He'll bring healing. He'll bring restoration to your house. Come on, you can't be responsible for nobody else. You're gonna be responsible for your house. So again, I love you tonight. I appreciate you tonight. Just allowing me to speak into your life tonight, and I just hope this has been a blessing to you tonight, because it was a blessing to me. You know. I gotta get back in that place with God. I mean, still sometimes it's still too much TV. Come on, the devil don't rest. So you taking too much rest. You gotta pray. Man should always pray and not faint. So again, tonight, you know, the ministry still goes forward. You know, we don't charge for the word of God, but if God laid on your heart to be a blessing, we got some ways you can give: PayPal, you know, texting church and all that there. You know, you can sow a seed into the church, and we appreciate it. Everything you do, we pray over your seeds. Again, we're not in the building. We're getting ready in July to go back into the building. And again, we're praying. We're getting everything in order. Palace of Praise, I'm going to give you that date. We're all going back in there in July. But we're going to do things different. You know, we want to make sure everybody's covered with masks and stuff like that. We want to make sure our kids are protected. We want to make sure if you're not feeling good, to stay at home. You can't be offended by if they checking your temperature, because we want to look out for everybody. Because the devil would love to just to be able to just cause some destruction in the body of Christ. So we're going to make sure that we do all the things for God. Yes, I'm covered by the Holy Ghost. I'm sealed. But I ain't tempting God either. I believe warning come before destruction. I believe that God makes doctors and scientists and all this kind of stuff. And I believe that these people are trying to sound the alarm. And I think that the African-American, Hispanic people, I think this pandemic is hitting us hard because we're not listening. Everything is not a party. So let's make sure that you're covering yourself up. I'm in the funeral home business, and we are getting case after case after case after case. They have a funeral home here, then the whole funeral home had to shut down. Not our funeral home, but another funeral home had to shut down because everybody over there caught the corona. Come on, let's make sure. Don't give the devil no ground. Hallelujah. Hear me, church. Don't give the devil no ground. Protect your kids. And if your kids can't listen to you, they're going to be doing all this. Man, tell them, hey, look, might be time for you to get your own place. Because, again, we don't want to be tripping out here. We ain't giving this devil no ground. I want to live to see my great, great, great grandkids. Amen. So, again, let's be praying and let's keep me always lifted up in prayer. And so, again, I want to say hello to all our guests. We got a guest in Africa, Jamaica, Georgia, Dallas, Austin, New York, Louisiana, Mississippi. I'm telling you, I never thought I'd be on this here thing like this. I used to say, no, I can't do all that. But, you know, God has a way of bringing you out of your comfort zone. So these great men of God, some of these men of God are listening to us. Thank you so much for listening. Hey, you know, I'm not trying to be all grand and great. I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody. And God is great. Nobody's great but God. So, again, I want to pray. Again, always, if you're having any type of problems, we got a church office to call. We're going to try to help you out if you got food or whatever. Some of our members been eating food and stuff. We've been doing what we need to do. So if you need food and stuff, but listen to me. There are so many places out there doing things for you. Make sure you're utilizing everything. If you have a business, make sure you get the SBA. Go to them. They're giving out loans, low interest loans. If you got your business, just get your paperwork together and fill it out. It don't cost nothing to fill it out. So again, just make sure you stay connected. Again, I love you so much. We're going to pray and we're going to dismiss for this night. We're going to leave the room, but we're not going to leave the presence. You're going to turn off the screen, but you're not going to leave the presence. So let's pray real quickly. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus Christ for this word that you've given tonight. Now, Father, I pray that you would anoint this word to touch the hearts, the mind of your people. Father, I only speak it in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, you said that your word would never come back void. I pray that somebody is going to reposition their lives. Somebody's going to repent. Somebody's going to remember. Somebody's going to reposition. Somebody's going to return, God. And somebody's going to just start rejoicing. Now, Father, no matter what we go through, we got something to rejoice about. Father, you woke us up this morning. You gave us another day. I've got breath in my body. I got the activities of my limb. I can think, God. Oh, I had food to eat. It's so much to rejoice for and to be thankful for. Now, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that I believe in your healing power. Jesus Christ, I believe that you are the name that's above every name. Tonight, I pray that tonight that you would touch every heart, that you would touch every mind, God, that you would fulfill destiny and purpose, God. I pray that anything be stagnated in our lives, that, Father, you would touch it right now in the name of Jesus. I speak over God's people that no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. Father, we're not waiting to be the head. We're already the head and not the tail. We are lenders and not borrowers. Now, Father, I pray again that the favor of God, I speak favor right now. Let the favor of God rest over your people right now in the name of Jesus. Now, Father, I can only do things about myself. Help me to work on myself. Help me to fall in love with myself, God. And most of all, help me to fall deeply and more deeper and deeper in love with you. Father, I want to live the song. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. So, Father, I pray that it be done tonight. Now, Father, I pray this prayer will cover every area of our life. There's a couple right now that's going through marital problems right now. And I heard God say the victory that you all need is in the Word of God. Thank you, Father, for victory in the Word of God. Somebody's stuck. Somebody's stuck. And God say, you're so busy. I hear God saying this here about somebody on this line. You're focusing on the wrong things. And sometimes we've got to let some chapters go. Sometimes we want people to repay what they don't want to repay. God say to count it all. Just let it go. Just write it off. And God said, when you write it off, God said, I'm going to write another number in. Whatever you lost, whatever they owe you, God said, let it go, and I'm going to replace it double for all your trouble. So, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus tonight. I want to let you have free reign tonight. Somebody, I hear God say, in this season, it's time for you to take a giant step. And God said, I want you to take a step so long till it hurts and it makes you feel like you're about to fall. And God said, you've been taking too many little steps. It's time for you to step out into the deep. And God said, I'm going to be in the deep. And God said, I want you to be covered and immersed in me to where I can prove myself to you. Father, I pray tonight. I thank you for your word tonight. I thank you that ministry are being birthed right here. And I hear God say tonight to tell my people, every ministry is not behind a pulpit. God said the world is your ministry. And God said there are different places, there are different people, there's different groups I want you to meet. God said we can put a pulpit anywhere that he desires. God said when you get in alignment with me, I'm going to order your steps. I see somebody in an apartment complex right now, and God said you're going to start an apartment complex, and it's going to grow and grow and grow and grow. I hear God. God said the favor of God is being released. This is the time, God said, not to lean to your own understanding. Every step that you take is a strategic step in me. God said, I have ordered steps. I have ordered steps. And when you step into that position that I have you to be, there will be what you need will be there. God said, I am a God who meets all needs. Come on, preacher. I hear some preachers that are getting tired and weary. God said the reason why you're getting tired and weary because you're trying to do it yourself. God said, I never asked you to carry the burden of the ministry. I asked you to pray and I asked you to release and give it to me. What's happening is you are not activating your faith. You are allowing the pressures of ministries to almost crush you, to make you give up. God said, cast all your cares upon me. God said, I'm getting ready to rebirth. I'm getting ready to breathe back in your ministry and I'm going to breathe back in your life. God said, don't make another move without consulting me, said the Lord. I hear God speaking tonight. So again, bless the people of God. I love you so much. If this has been a blessing, share it, start some watch parties. And most of all, keep praying for me. Come on, pray for me. We're praying for the church. We're praying for every member. Don't think because I hadn't called your name, I'm praying. I always pray for every member. Even our past ministers are going on to other ministries. I pray for you because guess what? God always told me to pray for our past, our present, and our future members, to keep praying for them. Because anytime that I connect you with something, there was a reason for the connection. So God never told me to stop praying. So again, I love you so much. Again, keep the church lifted up. Come on, let's stay unified. Let's stay unified. Remember, together we win. Again, palace, I say this again. It's no more about one or two people getting all the glory, standing out. No, we're going to win together. We're going to lock hands together. We're going to get to the finish line together. If one eat, we all eat. If one got it, we all got it. That's the ministry that God gave me. Any other kind of ministry, find it somewhere else. Love you much, Pastor E. Pastor E, I'm out. Have a wonderful, 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 wonderful day. Hugs and kisses. Come on, let's give God some praises before we leave. Can we set up 100 hearts real quick to God? Come on, come on. That's going to just say, God, I love you. God, I thank you. Mother, love you. Praying for you. God got you. God got you. God got you. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, praying for you. Just 100 hearts. Just keep sitting up. Ramon, send some hearts up. I thank God for you, man. You and your beautiful wife. Keep the faith. Keep believing. Keep believing. Keisha, I love you. Keisha, let me give you this word. God told me to tell you. I was supposed to call it, but I'm going to tell it to you on this line. God told me, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials that come to test you. God say, even in your family, there are trials that are coming to test you, to prove you. God say, stand on the word because God has made you a light for your family. Let me tell you something. You are a blessed woman. You are a prosper woman. I see God opening up programs that you're going to birth out of you. It's so much in you. And God said, this is your season where it's all going to come out. Let me say, before the blessing, the storm will come. The attacks will come. But can you persevere through the storm? And God is going to give you victory. Come on, you bless, you bless. You love people. You can bring people together. Let me tell you something. God is going to use what he put inside of you for favor, sister. Love you much. Love you much. Amen, amen. Again, love you. Be encouraged. Keisha, tell your husband, stay encouraged. Pray with your husband. Amen. Anthea, love you, love you, love you, love you, love you. Jackie Grooms, love you, love you. Brenda, love you. Pastor Free, all of you all, I love you. Thank God for allowing me to be your pastor. I love all of y'all. Y'all held my hands up in difficult times, and I shall never forget that. Stella McDuffie, bless you, woman of God. Bless you, bless you. Bless you, bless you. Sonya Driver, love you, sister. Come on. Victory's in the end. We got to endure to it. I promise you, Sonya, we're going to be happy. God's got a blessing with our name on it. And that's what he told me. a tailor-made blessing can't nobody wear but you, said the Lord. It's coming forth. Again, love you much. And Thea, you know I love you, sister. I love you. Carolyn, bless you, bless you, bless you. Bless the people of God. Have a wonderful, wonderful night. Love you. God bless you. Have a wonderful night. Pastor, I'm out.